Have you ever wandered lonely through the woods? And everything that feels just as it should. You're part of a life there, you're part of something good. If you've ever wandered lonely through the woods. Ooh. If you've ever wandered lonely through the woods. Have you ever stared into a starry sky? Lying on your back, you're asking why. What's the purpose? I wonder who am I? If you've ever stared into a starry sky.
My name is Matt, and I'm one of the pastors at Commonway. And thank you for joining us this morning, or if you're watching this later. Worshiping together as a church family online is obviously something new for us. And so we are going to learn as we go and have things to work out. And so thank you for your patience. One thing for sure, this isn't going to be perfect, but I am really grateful that we have this option, that we have this opportunity to worship together while being apart. Well, along with this format, we have a chance to try some new things. We don't have to do everything from like up here, and we were kind of thinking many of you are in your kitchens and in your living rooms, and so parts of this then, we have an opportunity to join you from our living rooms as well, because we can. And so here's the plan for our time together. Our worship leader, Cliff, is just getting back from spring break and being in the woods, like in isolation. And so our youth pastor, Bobby and Molly, are going to lead us in a couple of songs. And so feel free to join in from home. We have some announcements to share after that. Jeremy is going to lead us in a prayer for just the season of unknown, the circumstances that we're in. And then I'll be bringing the message as much as like normal as possible. You should be familiar with this. And the nice part is when I make jokes and no one laughs, that I'll be right at home. Our prayer moving forward is that we could all be present, that we could all engage in worship, in prayer, in reflection, right where we are. Here's the good news. None of this limits God. We're all kind of out of our routine and out of our normal, and so who knows what God wants to do? Our prayer is that God uses this. And the fact that we are spread out does not keep God from being present with each one of us, from speaking to us, from challenging us. And so our prayer is that you sense God's presence, that we're all open, that we respond to him, and that we can encourage one another during this time.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken, 'cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. The shame no longer has a place to I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. I won't be shaken. I won't be shaken. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance. There's power that can empty out the grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. There's power in your name, yeah. And there's power that can break off every chain. And there's power that can empty out. And there's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. There's power in your name. 'Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
Hey, good morning, Commonway. We are so glad to be joining you on the internet this morning. We might not be in the same room, but we are in the same spirit this morning. So thank you so much for joining us. Happy Sunday.
Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. and bright that I am made. I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
Well, good morning, everyone. Welcome to Commonway Church and to my kitchen. My name is Gus. I'm the college pastor here. I have my cereal, Cinnamon Toast Crunch, the foundation to any healthy diet, soaked in some milk I had to get in a fist fight for at Walmart, but I made it out. It's good to be with you this morning, even if it's in kind of a strange setting. It's comforting to me to know that we're all together. Just a few announcements this morning. Largely just some housekeeping on how we're going to do things. First up, you know, this is how we're going to do Sunday morning services, at least for a little while. So, you know, next week we'll be having our service at the same time on a page like this. Some of you will be happy to know we will have interactive events available for kids. Jill is going to roll out some stuff for Commonway Kids next Sunday. So, I don't know if maybe you're sick and tired of your kids at this stage of the game, or the quarters have been a little bit tight at home, they will have something to do at that time, which I'm sure you'll be grateful for. Likewise, the youth group, Bobby's going to have some interactive things as well on Sunday morning. So stay tuned for that. And stay tuned just for multiple different things as we're trying to figure out ways to stay connected virtually. Pay attention to your emails as well as the Commonway Facebook page for information on how we're going to do some things. You know, each week we always invite prayer requests to be written down for us to be praying for as a staff. And, you know, we definitely want to continue to do that. I'm sure a lot of us want to be praying, or to be praying with someone, or have someone praying for us. There's a button at the bottom of your screen right now that you can click and type in a prayer request that somebody will see. So we'll definitely be praying with you as a staff throughout the week. And likewise, you can get on to the Commonway Church website, and there will be a button on our homepage for you to click and write down a prayer request. You know, we certainly want to be looking out for each other. And if you feel like you've got a need and you need someone to be praying for you and to hear you, absolutely submit a prayer request, and we're always happy to be praying for you and with you in those. You know, each week this is also when we would, you know, pass the plate for our time of giving our offering. We can't really do that. So just to let you know, there are still ways to give. You can mail a check to the church, which some people already do, so you can continue to do that. That'll still work. And then there's a button at the top of your screen this morning that says give, and you can give there, as well as on the Commonway Church website. So just some information on how that can still work. Well, it's good to be with you, even if it's virtually and in a different way this morning. And it's comforting for me to know that we're all still together in one way or another. So I miss you, and I know we miss being together, but it's good to be with you this morning, and we'll see you sometime.
Well, hey everybody, welcome to my living room, to my home, and we would just want to take a moment right now and pray together. So if you will, please. Father in heaven, we thank you, first and foremost, that you are a good God, that you are faithful, and that you are full of mercy. And Lord, we ask that you would be with us, that you would send your Holy Spirit to surround us, to go before us and beside us. God, that you would calm our anxiety. Lord, that you would calm our nerves. And Lord, that you would give us that peace that passes all understanding. God, to the core of who we are. And God, as we face the uncertainty and the disappointments of these coming days, God, that you would be with us, that you would be our hope and our joy and our strength. And God, also, that you would give us ways to connect and be together despite the circumstances. But Lord, most of all, we ask for your protection. God, that you would surround us, that you would keep us from harm, that you would keep us whole, that you would keep us healthy, that you would keep us safe. And Lord, most of all, we thank you for your Son, for his life, his death, and his resurrection. God, and the promises that you have, that you will be with us always. So we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, we are picking up on where we left off a couple weeks ago in our series on prayer. And I don't know if anybody remembers this at this point because it feels like so long ago. But that means we are ready to talk about unanswered prayer. You know, as a pastor, one of the hardest things to walk through with people are these moments, these situations where someone is going through something like really difficult. I mean, like a sudden illness, a financial hardship, something with one of our kids, a struggle with infertility, some urgent crisis. I'm thinking about those situations in life where there's just like nothing left that you can do. You're just out of options. Like only God can do anything. And so, of course, they're praying and we're praying and it seems like everyone is praying and we're trusting God and we're praying in faith for God to do something in the desperate situation because we believe God can. And yet the person doesn't get better. The situation or relationship isn't fixed, or you lose something or someone significant. And as a pastor, I gotta tell you, I have seen just the most heartbreaking examples of this, some even quite recently. And so maybe you've been there. Perhaps you're going through something like this right now. My question is, what do you do with that? And we probably all have things that we have prayed for earnestly, persistently, like I'm talking trusting God, maybe even pleading in prayer, and yet nothing. And we've concluded that by any reasonable standard of judgment, that the prayer is simply going unanswered. In the words of Emily Dickinson, there comes an hour when begging stops, when the long interceding lips perceive their prayer is vain. So why are some prayers answered and some prayers not? Look, I don't doubt that God answers prayer. I believe miracles still happen. I mean, as we've been saying the past few weeks, according to Jesus, our prayers do make a difference. That when we pray, there are some things that happen that don't happen if we don't pray. And so I don't struggle with whether or not God answers prayers. I have too many stories in my own life of this happening. Not to mention the testimonies and what I've seen and heard. I've just seen and heard too much to deny that. But I have struggled at times with the inconsistency of those answers. I think about in my own life as I've grown in faith or gotten a little bit older, I've moved in my own life from emphasizing prayer as like only asking for things to seeing prayer more and more as primarily about being with God. That the primary goal of prayer is it's relational. It's being in God's presence. It's enjoying companionship with God. All that said, I realize that for many people, and again, maybe this is you, unanswered prayer, it can actually be a barrier that like gets in the way with even our desire to like want to be in companionship with God in the first place. Like what kind of companion who has the power to heal, who has the power to save a life, would sit like on the sidelines despite our urgent pleas for help? I mean, you could say, in a sense, every war, every epidemic, every drought, every premature death, every birth defect, it challenges the promise, the hope, the effectiveness in our minds of prayer. And so we all feel this tension at times. I want to start by just walking through some of the reasons from Scripture for unanswered prayer. And as we're going to see, there are some prayers that can't be answered. There are others that likely won't be answered and various things here. And I am drawing some from a book by Philip Yancey called Creatively Prayer. And so I encourage you, if you're looking for a good book on this subject. First of all, some prayers go unanswered because they are, and I struggled with the right language here, but they're frivolous or foolish or essentially self-serving. I think of praying like, Lord, please help it to be sunny for the picnic. You know, in some ways, you could make the case that that trivializes prayer, especially when like the farmer down the road with much bigger things in mind and consequences is praying for rain. There are certain prayers that kind of turn God into like a vending machine. I think about the last ditch prayer, God, please help me to get an A on this, I guess, online test, right? I haven't studied, I haven't done any work, but God, I need a miracle. We've all seen athletes kind of chest thumping, pointing to the big guy upstairs, right? Giving him credit, I guess, for the touchdown, the goal, the home run, or whatever. Or how about this? Janis Joplin singing, Oh Lord, won't you buy me a, Mercedes-Benz. Some of you just revealed your age with that. I mean, I can pray all day, every day for God to like make me taller, and it's probably not going to happen. The New Testament actually highlights several foolish, frivolous at times, self-serving requests made directly to Jesus. I think about Peter, who's like overwhelmed by the sudden appearance of Moses and Elijah along with Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. And so Peter impulsively asks Jesus that like shelters be built for these two time travelers, and Jesus, he's just saying words. He doesn't even really know what he's saying. Or when the disciples James and John, along with their ambitious mother, when they asked Jesus if they could receive prominent positions in Jesus' kingdom. And Jesus is like, no, you don't even know what you're asking for. And he just kind of shakes his head at how badly they've missed his message. See, the issue at the heart of these kinds of unanswered requests, kind of what they have in common, is they are a lot of times self-serving and not in line with who God is. They put the focus on us, on our things, on what we want. The Apostle James says this exact thing in James 4, verse 3. He says, when you ask, you do not receive because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your pleasures. In other words, it's all about you, and that's it. Second, some prayers go unanswered because of an issue with the person praying. In other words, the prayer itself is fine, but perhaps something is off with me. Now, I hesitate to mention this one because of the way that this gets misused, so more on that in a second. But this is one of the reasons that Scripture gives repeatedly for unanswered prayers, and so we should talk about it. Throughout Scripture, we find that sometimes personal sin disrupts communication with God. Psalm 66:18 says, if I had cherished sin in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. This is actually made super clear in the words of the prophet Isaiah, who Isaiah in chapter 1, he's reporting these words from God. So this is God speaking to his people. Isaiah 1, verse 15, God says, when you spread out your hands in prayer, I hide my eyes from you. Even when you offer many prayers, I am not listening. Your hands are full of blood. Wash and make yourselves clean. Take your evil deeds out of my sight. Stop doing wrong. Verse 17. Learn to do right. Seek justice. Defend the oppressed. Take up the cause of the fatherless. Plead the case of the widow. In other words, God makes it clear that in addition to our private spiritual inward state that actually our social concern or lack of it, our concern for the poor, for widows, for orphans, that also has a direct bearing on how our prayers are received. Other prophets like Malachi get even more specific. Those who pay exploitative wages, those who treat immigrants badly, those who refuse to share food with the hungry or provide shelter to the homeless, risk closing God's ears to their prayer. Proverbs says rather bluntly, Proverbs 21:23, whoever shuts their ears to the cry of the poor will also cry out and not be answered. And there are New Testament passages connecting the effectiveness of our prayer to how we treat other people. Peter, in one of his letters, he says that husbands need to be considerate of their wives and treat them with respect so that nothing will hinder your prayers. See, along with this idea, there are certainly passages that connect the effectiveness of our prayer to the role of faith, faith on the part of the person praying. And I get it, that obviously that can be twisted and it can be used to condemn people, like, you know, you just don't have enough faith or whatever, which is why we're looking at also some other reasons for unanswered prayer, because there are more besides just you don't have enough faith or you've done something wrong or something wrong with me or whatever. Again, though, if prayer is primarily being with God, communion with God, I actually think it makes sense then that how we treat other people, people made in God's image, that affects our relationship with God. The Apostle John captures, this is like a really relational dynamic in prayer, when he says, we receive from him anything we ask because we keep his commands and do what pleases him. So prayer is more than just bowing my head a few times a day. It's actually tied to all of life. Another reason for unanswered prayer, some prayers are simply logically contradictory. So like if a dozen people are praying for the same single job, that means that 11 are going to have to come to grips with an unanswered prayer. Or here's this classic example. Two drivers are circling the same parking lot looking for a space. They both follow Jesus. They both go to Commonway Church. Just kidding. There's one parking space available. Uh-oh. Or more seriously, this happens a lot during war. In our nation's own civil war, there were Christians, believers, praying for victory on both sides. By the way, apart from impossible prayers, apart from logical contradictions, here's maybe a bigger question. What would happen if God answered every prayer? This scenario actually plays out exactly in the movie called Bruce Almighty. And so the answer from that movie, which has to be true, is it would be a disaster. In the movie, Bruce Nolan, played by Jim Carrey, is like this ordinary TV reporter who just kind of rages out at God after like this series of mishaps. And he ends up meeting God in person, played by Morgan Freeman, because who else? Who decides to let Bruce try being God for a week to see if he can do it better. And so Bruce, of course, uses his powers like a magic genie, you know, to part traffic or to get revenge on his enemies or to impress his girlfriend, just with all kinds of unintended consequences. But Bruce also, in the role of God, acting as God, he hears all of the prayer requests from everyone at once around the world. And at one point, just being overwhelmed, he answers yes to everyone who's praying to win the lottery, thus granting 400,000 winners and diluting the payout to like nothing. The point of the movie is that Bruce learns some humility and an appropriate sense of inadequacy. He also learns an appreciation for like the complexity of prayer, for the consequences of God kind of overruling the natural world. Someone once asked Gandhi, if you were given the power to remake the world, what would you do first? And Gandhi said, I would pray for power to renounce that power. It's interesting. It turns out that Jesus, in many ways, did actually renounce some of his power. Of course, he did miracles, but not on a global stage. His response, when he did them, it was always motivated by compassion, not by spectacle. In fact, a lot of times he made people promise not to tell anyone about the healing or what had taken place. And certainly Jesus never acted with his influence, his power for self-promotion or even self-protection. In other words, even Jesus was careful to respect that balance of what happens when supernatural power impacts this world. On top of that, if God answered every prayer, even those we pray with good motives on our part, in a lot of ways, free will would be gone. Like, I can pray with good motives for someone to like turn their life around. And if God answered that, bam, just did that in that person's life with or without their cooperation, our choice would be gone. So yeah, of course, in prayer, God can influence others, but God doesn't manipulate. If this happened, that also means that the laws of physics would be superseded so regularly. What's the point in having like fixed laws that govern the universe? C.S. Lewis talked about how miracles are, by definition, rare. That's why we call them miracles and not everyday experience. It's also possible God doesn't answer some prayers because he actually has something better for us that we just can't see from where we are right now. It reminds me of the Garth Brooks song, some of you have already thought of, Unanswered Prayer. In the song, he's reflecting on being in love with this girl in high school, and he was convinced he wanted to marry her. And long story short, I guess it didn't work out. And he sees her years later and like breaks into this spontaneous God prayer of thanks. I guess I dodged a bullet there or whatever. It kind of makes me wonder, how would that feel to be the girl? Anyway, international best-selling song written about me, but okay. Okay, country music isn't your thing. That's fine. How about this? In the words of Oscar Wilde, when the gods wish to punish us, they answer our prayers. By the way, how many of us could tell a story of there was this thing that I wanted? I was praying. I was convinced was like the right path or decision or thing for me. And how grateful I am looking back that God didn't answer that particular prayer. And so thankfully, there are times when God says no, because he has something better for us or better for the world down the road. There are a few other reasons, or several others, but a few that I'll just mention without having time to really get into them. For unanswered prayer, we've kind of touched on this, God's respect for human freedom, his refusal to coerce, his commitment to honoring our choices. According to Jesus, said this many times, that there were actually our evil forces contending, working against God. So there's what God wants, but then there's like personified evil pursuing things that are against that. You have this and our choices that aren't always great, and you have this, which leads to ultimately a planet that is marred with disease, epidemics, violence, the potential for tragedy. Of course, life is tough. And to quote Paul, creation has not yet been liberated from, to use his phrase, from its bondage to decay. As Jesus said, in this world, you will have trouble. And so this is going to be the case in our experience until Jesus returns. I actually find it oddly comforting when you think about the several prayers in Scripture that were not answered. We touched on Moses a couple weeks ago, who he gets to the end of his life, 40 years leading the Israelites through the wilderness, and his like last prayer is, God, allow me to accompany the Israelites across the Jordan and to die then. And God says no. We had seen other times when it seems Moses was able to like convince God to change his mind. In this case, God stuck with no. Or I think about King David, who spent a week lying face down, refusing to eat, praying that his infant son not die. The prayer went unanswered. There were four characters in the Old Testament, Moses, Job, Jonah, and Elijah, who actually prayed to die. And fortunately for them, God ignored their request. Several times the armies of Israel prayed for victory over their enemies only to suffer like humiliating defeats. Jeremiah, a faithful prophet, prayed that Jerusalem not be destroyed by their enemies. And spoiler alert, it was. I just want to make it very clear with all of this that prayer is not a formula. It's not get your life in order and say the right words and then the desired result will come. If that were true, Job would have avoided a whole lot of suffering. If that were true, Paul would have avoided the thorn in his flesh that he asked repeatedly and unsuccessfully for God to remove. Even Jesus, praying in the garden for the cup of suffering to be taken from him, would not have had to go to the cross. Now, I want to add one more layer to this problem of unanswered prayer. For many of us, you know, watching this, a lot of this makes sense, you know, in our minds. Of course, it's much more difficult to accept or deal with when unanswered prayer affects us, like when it really hits home and it's not just a theory, when someone we love is suffering, when our prayers aren't being answered in an area where the stakes are really high, and we feel afraid, and we feel anxious. Here's the thing that makes this more difficult, if we're being honest, right? When we read what Jesus says about prayer, it sounds like there need not be any unanswered prayer. It sounds like all we need to do is ask, right? Or at worst, there might be times when we have to ask boldly and like repeatedly, but then in the end, we'll get what we want. Do you realize Jesus could have said this about prayer? He could have said, I'm giving you this gift of prayer. And you realize, of course, humans have limited wisdom, and so there are limits, Jesus could have said, on whether your prayers will be answered. He could have said prayer operates, therefore, more like a suggestion box. And so, you know, spell out your request clearly to God. And I guarantee you that all requests will be carefully considered. I can actually live with that. That actually seems fair to me. If Jesus says that, a lot of the tension we feel around unanswered prayer diminishes. Here is what Jesus said instead. John 14, verse 13, and I will do whatever you ask in my name so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. You may ask me for anything in my name and I will do it. He says it twice. Or next chapter, John 15, verse 7, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. Fairly straightforward, isn't it? A few verses later, John 15, verse 16, you did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go out and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. Here's one more, John 16, next chapter. Very truly I tell you, my Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. Not once, not twice, actually five times in just a few chapters, Jesus makes a promise, ask me for anything. And I will do it. Really? Really, Jesus? What about my loved one who never got better? What about my bad situation that only got worse? See, that's a tension that in a lot of ways is created by what Jesus clearly promised. One explanation of this, one way of understanding this that I actually don't like, but I'm going to mention. Some suggest that in these cases, Jesus was addressing specifically the 12 disciples and not everyone else and not all Jesus' followers everywhere. The thought being that he handpicked this 12 and he gave them certain privileges in prayer because of their mission and their unique role in starting the church. And so he made promises to them that are not universally granted to everyone. And people who make this case point out that in most of these instances, Jesus is clearly talking to the 12 and not to like the larger crowds. The problem with this is you can, and we've covered some of them, find clearly times when what the apostles prayed for didn't, when this didn't happen. And so very clearly prayer, even for them, wasn't like this magic thing. There's another, I think, better way of understanding this, which does include and apply to us today. And it focuses on the fact that virtually all of these promises have a qualifier, where Jesus clarifies, like here, whatever you ask, and then he adds this, in my name. Or he'll, in another place, say, if you remain in me. See, in the first century, someone's name, it embodied their nature, their essence, their character. We have turned in Jesus' name into like this magical incantation, this kind of open sesame thing that we tack on to the end of our prayer to make it like official or whatever. In the first century, that's not how they did it. In Jesus' name wasn't an add-on to the end of a prayer. It was a way of prayer. It was a posture. To pray in Jesus' name is to A, live a life, but B, embody a way of praying that's in line with Jesus' nature and his mission. Which means that to do this, we actually have to ask more difficult questions like, am I abiding and remaining in Christ? Am I making requests according to his will? Am I obeying his commands? Which all of that implies and underscores the idea of prayer as relationship, as companionship with God. This implies a sort of partnership with him, that the more we know God, the more we know God's will, the more likely our prayers align with that, and that we're moving in the same direction on mission with Jesus. My point is, a lot of things that we pray for today simply are not in Jesus' name. That's why God has yet to answer my prayer for like a Tesla, okay? Not exactly in line with Jesus' nature or mission. Prayer is not a formula. And for various reasons, including some that from our current vantage point, we can't understand these times when we pray and the answer seems to be no. Other times the answer isn't no, it's just not yet. Again, think about this relationally. If all of our prayers were answered instantly, God basically turns into like an ATM machine. Some prayers just haven't been answered yet. A delay is not necessarily a denial. So we have an invitation, an encouragement from Jesus himself even, that until we know beyond a shadow of a doubt that the answer is no, until that's unmistakably obvious, we can keep praying. And the truth is, we actually rarely know why our prayers go unanswered. As Paul says in 1 Corinthians 13, for now, we see only a reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face when we're with God. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And so one of the mysteries we have to embrace in this life is at times the mystery of unanswered prayer. Now, all of this said, I don't want to discourage you from actually praying. Like, wow, there's a lot of reasons for unanswered prayer. I mean, I guess no way my prayer is going to get through. Listen, I'm not trying to like decrease your faith. I just want to help us understand some of the reasons for unanswered prayer. But the overall headline, the overall point of this whole series is ask. Be bold. Trust. Have faith. I want to go back to something I said at the beginning. When it comes to prayers that, I don't know, seem a little bit frivolous or maybe self-serving. So I want to make a slight correction, especially when you're comparing it to like human suffering on like a global scale. I actually think there's probably even a place for these kinds of prayers. I don't know that it's we can't ask as much as let's not lose faith when our prayers aren't answered. First of all, God very well might answer. Secondly, I don't know about you, but I have found that people who are willing to pray for like the little things, the daily things, are oftentimes like more grateful people. And I can get into like physics and the universe and all this philosophical stuff, but the person who says, God, would you please just give me a parking space? Or God, I'm feeling really, and it happens, and they're like, amazing. Or like, God, I'm feeling discouraged. Would you speak to me? And they turn on the radio, and it's like, that song was meant just for me. How incredible. See, to people with like that, I mean, everything is a gift. And I actually think there's something to be said for that, especially in a time like this. So here's how we're going to end. I have one more passage. I could have just started with this and not had a sermon because this sums up all of this. In the Old Testament book of Daniel, there are these three guys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And they get in trouble with King Nebuchadnezzar because they're supposed to be bowing down to this huge idol that Nebuchadnezzar has built and commanded everyone else, including them, to bow down to. And so they're warned if they don't do it, they're going to be thrown into the blazing furnace. And some of you know this story. Anyway, they keep refusing to bow down. They're eventually brought before King Nebuchadnezzar, presumably to be sentenced to execution. Daniel 3, verse 16. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to him, King Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to deliver us from it, and he will deliver us from your majesty's hand. I mean, look at their faith. Look at their confidence. Not only is God able to deliver us, he will deliver us. We are going to be just fine. But they don't end there. Watch what they say next. But even if he does not, we want you to know, your majesty, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold you have set up. Even if he doesn't answer our prayer like we hope, he's still God. He's still our hope, and he's still our future, and we are not going to abandon him no matter what happens. Here's what this means for us. Where do you need to be reminded the God I serve is able to fill in the blank with whatever you're facing? The God I serve is able to work in my finances, to open unexpected doors. The God I serve is able to bring healing. The God I serve is able to bring reconciliation or to work and intervene in my circumstance in dramatic in unmistakable ways. Where or what do you need to be remind yourself of? And as it comes to mind, maybe it even feels risky to say that out loud. So I want to encourage all of this. Because of this, because God is able, we can pray boldly. God, I know you're able to work. I know you're able to move, to intervene, to influence. Our God is a God of miracles. And so we ask in faith. But then here's the second part. But even if he does not, even if the answer isn't what I thought, even if the answer is apparently no, even if the answer seems to be perhaps not yet, even if option one, my preferred option, seems to be closing or closed, God, I still trust you. I believe you have good intentions for me. I know you love me, that you are still my hope. You're still my future. Would you join me? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we come before you, and again, thank you for the incredible privilege and opportunity of prayer to experience communion, companionship, connection with you. Lord, I pray for each person watching this who we're going through something difficult and we've been praying, we've been pleading, we've been asking for some of us again and again. And the answer seems to be no, or perhaps not yet. Lord, help us to know what to do with that. Help us to maintain our confidence in you in spite of this mystery that from our vantage point in this life, there just are going to be questions we don't have answers to, things we wonder about, things we don't understand. So Lord, we just confess that our hope and our trust is in you, not in our circumstances, not in what's happening around us. We trust you, we believe that you are good and that you love us and that your intentions toward us are good. May we maintain our confidence and our hope in you no matter what. It's in Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, thank you all again for worshiping with us in kind of a new way. God be with you, and we'll see you again next week.